Let's assume that we have a population with a mean of mu and a standard deviation of sigma. And we want to take samples of size n from this population. And let us assume that n is a relatively big number, so we are taking big samples from that population. If we look at the first sample and add all of the observations in that sample and find the mean of the sample, we call the mean of the first sample x1 bar. Now, if we take another sample of size n, it will have a set of different observations in it, and the mean of the second sample would be x2 bar. But intuitively, we don't expect that the mean of the second sample would be very much different than mean of the first sample, because the observations in the sample, would some of them would be big, some of them will be small, and they cancel each other. The single individuals in the population can vary very much. But the average of a sample, the average itself doesn't vary very much because big numbers and small numbers cancel each other. So x1 bar and x2 bar, we don't expect that they would be very, very different. If we take another sample, again, the observations in this sample, we assume that are simple random samples. And for one sample mean to be very different than other sample means, it means that the values of that sample should be either from the very right tail of the distribution in the population or from the very left tail of the distribution of the population. And if you have a simple random sample, it is not expected to happen. We continue taking all possible samples and look at their means from x1 bar to xi bar, then this sample mean by itself makes a variable for us. It's a sampling variable that for every sample it would be different. If we think about the distribution of this variable, it will have a concentration around somewhere, and then it will be varying. The variation of this distribution wouldn't be as much as the variation of the population. This is the only thing that we can intuitively say. But we don't know where is the concentration of this distribution, what is the shape of the distribution, and we don't know where is the location of the mean, what is the standard deviation of this distribution. So to find out the answer to these questions of how the sample means are going to vary, we do a number of mental exercises which will enable us to discover how is this shape. If we subtract the mean of the population from each sample mean, this will give us how much a sample mean has deviated from the mean of the population. Let's call that one dx bar, or the deviation of each x bar from the mean of the population. If we subtract this constant, the mean of the population from each x bar, the concentration and the shape of the distribution of these sample means is not going to change, but the location of the concentration will shift. Still, we'll have the same distribution. So this is the distribution of deviations of x bar from the mean. Now let's think, what would be the shape of this distribution? Okay, to understand that, let's do another change. If we divide the deviation of each sample mean from the mean of the population by standard deviation of the population divided by square root of n, this standard deviation of the population divided by square root of n is another constant. So basically, we are scaling, but the shape of the graph will not change. But with these two transformations that we did, we shifted the location of the concentration of this distribution and we scaled it. And by that, we get a variable, another variable, let's call it z. Now, we can study the distribution of this z, and it turns out that we will have very interesting findings. Central limit theorem is a theorem that says if we look at the distribution of a variable such as z, we will discover that it will have a normal distribution with a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. Now let's see if we know this about variable z. What do we know about the deviations of each mean from the mean of the population? If we look at the distribution of the mean deviations, we didn't do anything except scaling the deviations by a factor of sigma divided by a square root of n. So the shape of the deviations would have still a mean of 0, but because we scaled it down and we got the standard deviation of 1 for z, the standard deviation of this distribution would be sigma divided by square root of n. And if that is true about the deviations of each mean from the mean of the population, this is the only thing that we did to get this distribution was to subtract the constant from mean of each sample. So the distribution of sample means would have still a normal distribution, but this time the location of the mean would change to mu, and the standard deviation would remain to be sigma divided by square root of n. We discovered that the distribution of sample means will be a normal distribution with a mean of the mean of the population. So mu of x bar is the mu of the population, and the standard deviation of x bar would be a standard deviation of the population divided by square root of n, which is sigma of x bar is sigma of the population divided by square root of n. And this will enable us to predict things about the behavior of x bar, because we know how normal distribution is distributed. For example, we know that if we take all possible samples of size n from the population, 95.4% of x bars will be within two standard deviations of the mean. But the normal distribution that now we are dealing with is the distribution of x bar. So standard deviation of x bar is sigma divided by square root of n. Therefore, we discovered that 95.4% of x bars will be between mu minus 2 sigma divided by square root of n and mu plus 2 sigma divided by square root of n.